So step one, let's go back, organize and prepare for success. The first thing I'm going to talk about, it was mentioned by Dale, and I think it's really important, is time. How you spend your time as a salesperson is incredibly important. And for those in the room who have heard Phil Jones, MBE, speak, he spoke at one of our events recently. He said a great saying on this. He used the calendar as an example. Your diary is your statement of intent. Your diary is absolutely your statement of intent. If you leave here at 12 o'clock for lunch, get out your phone and look at your diary from last week and for the week ahead. What does your diary say about you? What does your diary say about you? I do this exercise in sales workshops with salespeople, and I ask them to write down what is in their diary from the last week to the fourth week. And if you've got more internal meetings and process and administration and stuff that is not going to impact those seven things on that cycle, and it outweighs the amount of sales, true sales activity you're doing, you need to make a change. What does your diary say about you? It is really important to manage your time if you're going to organise and prepare for success. The second tip I'm going to give you on organising and prepare for success is on reciprocation. And this is something that nobody really talks about in sales, and I talk about it a lot in leadership and engaging people and cultures in businesses. But I've been in the military and I've been in the business world, and there are two types of reciprocation, conditional and unconditional. In the military, reciprocation is entirely unconditional. If you ask anybody who's carried out an act of bravery or put others before themselves or done something in the heat of the moment, you say, why did you do that? They will always say along the same lines, because they would have done the same for me. It's unconditional whether that person has served with you for one day or one year. Business, however, since coming into the business world, it's entirely conditional, right? The essence of business is, I'll give you a product or service, you give me money. That in the essence is conditional. It's okay. It's not fickle. It's okay. But you need to understand this in sales. And the best salespeople I come across are the puppet masters. They are socially excellent. They go into every corner of their organization. They build allies with different departments and different people. They live in their client's business, and they have as many non-sales meetings as sales meetings, so they can build allies and friends. And they go first, and that's the thing. You've got to go first. Don't wait for, say, oh, what's that person ever done for me? Or I aren't meeting with that person because they don't have any budget and can't make the decision. You've got to try and change that. Time is precious, but when you go out into your clients' organisations and in your own, and you go first and do things for other people, you build up a favour bank to be able to pull upon at a later stage. Reciprocation is really important if you're going to succeed. The final point I want to talk about on step one, organise and prepare for success, is if you go away from today, another action for you, draw a line down the middle of a piece of paper and write resources and resourcefulness on each side. And what I observe in sales teams, when people are not performing too well, they start to look at the lack of resources as an excuse to why they're not performing. We don't have enough training. We don't have any support. I don't have the right customer base. They don't have any budget. They blame a lack of resources for you know, the lack of their success. Now, what I want you to do is write all the resources you have available in your business today to help you support the sale. Equipment, data, a CRM system, colleagues, experts, testimonials from current customers. Anything you can regard as a resource, I want you to write on that side of the list. And then what I want you to do is step across, and in resourcefulness, I want you to write down everything you don't have, or everything that you struggle with that is at this time out of your control. And all that is saying is, right now, this is something that I need to bridge. I need to be resourceful in this area. Let me give you an example, a personal example of this. When I worked for a $4 billion global consulting firm, and my business card at the time was my passport into any buyer's office. The brand of the company carried me in to step five straight away. So it was a real honor for me to do that for 7 years. I then set up my own business, and Dale will resonate me on this, and I sat on, and anybody in the room will set you up, I sat with a PC on day one with no resources, no brand, no nothing, and it was me, a phone, and a computer. And it was. So I thought, what's the quickest way I can get my brand out there to say, you should work with me and my company, and I should come into your business to deliver leadership, management, and sales training. I know I'll go and speak at all the conferences around the UK. People will see me. The social proof of what I do will get across, and then I'm bound to get loads of meetings and customers, right? So I rang up the conferences, not talking about the sales conversion conference here, but I rang up some of the, I went big. You know, the big national conferences in front of thousands of people. And I said, I'm Martin Johnson from Trans2 Performance. Yeah. I'm a motivational speaker. I wasn't. And I want to come and speak at your conference. And they said, yeah, Martin, no problem. Send me a video of you speaking in front of 200 people or more, two separate videos, and we'll see if you want, we'll have you on. So I'm thinking, geez. I said, well, I haven't got a video with me speaking in front of 200 people, but I'm hoping if you put me on the stage, I will then get the video in front of 200 people. No, it doesn't work like that, Mr. Johnson. We're going to have to... So I put the phone down. I rang every conference, practically, that year, I think including the sales conversion conference, and it was the same thing. Send me a video. We have to see the social proof. We have to see you. Now, at that point, I could have gone, it's not happening for me. Nobody will have me on. The world's against me. I'm a victim. I took £10,000 of my own money. We rented the deep aquarium out in Hull. We launched a brand called T2 Talks. I convinced 200 people to come into the audience and three other speakers to speak with me on the evening. All in a gamble, I hired a professional video company to come and video it professionally, and all in a bid that this would pay off. We sold it out. It was a hugely successful night. Since then, we've delivered three sellout T2 Talks to over 700 people. And guess who comes ringing now year on year to come and speak at the conferences? Not you. Guess who comes and rings now to speak at the conferences? Too late, I'm busy. I'm not, by the way. We absolutely accept. But the point is the only way that I could get over that hurdle is to become resourceful. It wasn't there, it wasn't happened for me. I didn't have the immediate resources, but I got resourceful, and now we have our own leading event, and we get more than enough invitations to speak at conferences and events. You have to draw a line between what resources you have in sales and where you need to be resourceful. And if you do this, you will avoid becoming a victim of your environment. You will be hungry. You will make things happen. Step one, organise and prepare for success. Step two, carry out white space analysis. It is really important to not just go off, I believe, as an ex-machine gunner who went off just calling everybody and spraying our products and service around and trying to just hit something, you know, anybody, just buy from me. I've been there. It's a lot of work. It can be soul destroying, right? And you're not too productive with it. Now, I'm still believe in activity, as I'm going to come on to. But white space analysis allows you to prepare accordingly so that the people you are calling upon stand the greatest opportunity of buying your product or service. Does that make sense? Creating attack lists, called lists, priority lists. It might be by industry, by job title, by company. I found something really interesting out with a client I was working with, and I'm going to ask the same question to you, and you can write this down. What's your bio data look like? What does your bio data in your business today look like? What is bio data? Well, all you have to do is take your existing customer base, analyze it, and you will find commonalities in 80% of your customers. Are there between? I'll tell you what is at Trans2 that I found recently. 80% of our revenue in that two-year period has come in companies between the revenue streams of 5 million and 25 million in turnover. And the reason that revenue has come from that is because they've reached their plateau of productivity in organic growth, and they're trying to kick on now past the 25 million up into the 50-100 million, and they need to invest in people, training, sales, management, leadership. So I found in my bio data, if we call upon companies between 5 million and 25 million, they're going to reach their plateau. They're going to have a need for our services, and that's what happens. What does your bio data look like? A client I worked with recently, he found 80% of his clients were multi-site retailers in the UK. And he was trying to go all over prospecting the financial sector, and it wasn't happening. Why? Fish in the multi-site retailer pond, it's your bio data. You're calling upon the people who stand the best chance of buying your product or service. Does that make sense? White space analysis is really important if you're going to then move to step three and your activity is going to pay off. So step three, We're organised, we're prepared, we've done our white space. This is what sometimes some of us love and embrace. As an ex-telesalesperson making 100 calls a day, first 3 months of that role, it was hell. I felt like walking out time and time again. 4 months, my name went from the bottom of the board to the top of the board, and I started to embrace and enjoy it. Then I started walking around with my headset on. You know that, the worst nightmare on a sales floor. You know the more reserved people are going, sit down and shut up, will you? And you're giving it the big wolf on Wall Street. And I really started to enjoy the process because, you know, it's fundamentally what sales is about, but it can be uncomfortable. If you haven't read it already, I'm going to give you several book tips throughout this talk and a couple of papers to read. There's a paper called The Common Denominator of Success by Albert E. Gray. Has anybody read it in the room? The Common Denominator of Success by Albert E. Gray. It was written in the 1940s, and it was a survey, it was a body of research that was done in the insurance sales market at that time. Now, you can imagine the 1940s and 50s, the core cutthroat element of sales started to rise, and insurance sales was seen as the premier sales role at the time. And he carried out a body of research on all the people in the insurance sales sector in America in that period of time. And he was looking for the common denominator of successful people. And what surprised him and what came out of that long study was a really simple fact. The common denominator of success was that the successful people formed a habit, to Dale's point, formed a habit of doing the things which the failures did not like to do. It was no silver bullet. The common denominator of success was that the successful people formed a habit of doing the things that the failures did not like to do. Prospecting, cold calling, driving high activity. They formed a habit of it, a relentless habit. And fast forward to today, and we live in a very different world. You know, that principle still exists today. But we have a different approach to prospecting now, and this is where I fundamentally go out on a bit of a limb when in my views of prospecting. We've done a body of research that actually of thousands of data points that said that 48% of buyers and decision makers in businesses today are millennials, people born after 1980 who approached their late teens by the turn of the millennium. 48% of people who buy or make a decision in a management role in businesses are millennials. By 2020, it will rise to the 60%. By 2025 to 2030, 70 to 80% of buyers and decision makers will be millennials. And millennials have done what? They've grown up with phones, social media, email, video, blogs. They've grown up with a different way of communicating. So cold calling is not dead, and I'm not here to say it's dead. But you have to start adapting and boxing clever when it comes to driving high activity. A blended approach is absolutely the way. The key for me, in my experience and success, is try to make the cold call a warm call. You try to make the cold call a warm call, and sometimes that might involve an email approach, sending a blog or a video first. So when you do make the call, that you've had one or two touches and you can refer to that, or it's a lead in. One of the ways we generate business, and Claire sat here who works at Trans2 is great at this. The amount of people I've spoke to cold who have said, yeah, Claire sends me your blogs every month. Claire sends me your videos from your T2 Talks nights, and I watched you talk on social excellence, or I watched you talk on organisational culture. And straight away, it's a warm call because we're doing the legwork first. And remember, not many millennials answer the phones these days. I don't. They'll leave a voicemail if it's important. Cold calling is still relevant, don't get me wrong. But if you think in 10 years' time, most of the people you're going to be calling upon, or your business is calling upon, will have grown up with a different way of communicating. And that's why a blended approach is a must. The last thing I'm going to talk about on driving high activity is about keep knocking. Think about Albert E. Gray's finding. Successful people formed a habit of doing the things the failures didn't like to do, and that is knocking. And I'm going to tell you a story. I had no right to join Gartner, a global business consultant, at the age of 24 years old. I had no right to go into a senior client director role in that business. But I worked for a smaller company at the time called Butler Group, a small 12 million advisory firm. And I was ringing Gartner every week. There was a guy, if this is on film and he watches it, I'll send him it because he'll laugh. There's a guy called Simon Maroos who was the lead recruiter for that company. And I rang him up as bold as brash saying, my name's Martin Johnson, I work for one of your competitors and I want to come and work for you, you're the global leader. Yeah, send me your CV, Martin, and we'll put you on file type thing and we'll let you know if there's any openings in the north. Because it was a global company out in the US but headquartered in London. So I rang back 2 weeks later, hi Simon, it's Martin, any roles going yet in the north? No, Martin, I'll let you know if there's anything going, send me your CV, we'll keep you on file. And I just kept knocking and knocking and knocking month after month, is there any jobs, Simon? Simon, hit your CV, Simon, I've just made the top sales man. What? He said, Martin, I will see you at Manchester service station, stop ringing me, I will see you. I can't promise anything, but I will see you. I said, great, good, I'll see you there next week. I went to Manchester service station. We had a conversation and it was a wonderful conversation. And he said, you don't strictly match the criteria. You are quite green, I think he used the word. And, you know, this is a senior role and all the rest of it. And I said, yeah, but Simon, I can sell. Look, you're here. And he was like, Jesus Christ. In the end, right, he said, I'll tell you what you do, you come down to Egham, you come down to London, we'll do a panel in front of 12 people. If you stand up there for 15 minutes and then we'll have a round the table vote, it was that cutthroat, round the table vote. If the vote is yes, we'll give you a shot, if not, it's no. I said, deal. Deal. I went to the panel, sort of ready to go, ready to rock, and I delivered 15 minutes of why me. Didn't talk about sales, my techniques, company, why me, why the deep-seated burning sense of purpose that is going to be above and beyond any other salesperson who works for you. I had, a 99.9% vote to give me a shot. And as I said, within 7 years, I grew in that business to be able to lead a $5 million part of it. You've got to keep knocking. You've got to keep knocking. It's hard. You've got to be resilient. And Albert E. Gray's theory from the 1940s that the common denominator of success is that successful people form a habit of doing the things failures do not like to do. It's as simple as that. And we'll talk a little bit more about some techniques. Step four. So this is the final part of the first four steps. We're organized, we're prepared for success. Yeah, we've created white space analysis. We have now driven our high activity and we've been relentless and we've got ourselves some meetings. Let me ask you this question, if you're the same as me. I run a business, I'm a father of three, I've got a beautiful wife and a nice life, but there is still no greater self-fulfillment to me than when I get a meeting in the diary. My wife will lynch me if she hears me say that, right? But there is still no greater self-fulfillment. Oh, there is, actually, when you come away from the meeting and you've nailed it. But there's still no greater self-fulfillment when I'm going to meet somebody who's senior, who's a decision-maker, and we stand a chance of winning that business. I come alive when this happens, and it's about preparing for that meeting. And the simple way to do it is I want you to think about some things. Some salespeople know if you've been doing what you do for a long period of time, you start resting on that experience, don't you? I've got a meeting Friday, I've done this 1,000 times, I can roll up. Always try to remember these four principles. You've got to prepare for the company, the person, the meeting and the outcome, because they're entirely different things. The company, anything you can find out on the website, company financial reports. What I often do, as soon as I get that meeting in the diary, I go to Google and I set up a Google alert for the company. It's really simple to do. You set up a Google alert, guess what's going to land in your inbox in the next 2 weeks? Every announcement that surrounds the company, a new appointment, an acquisition, something celebrated in the media, a new product launch, a big customer win, a big contract, anything you can leverage so when you walk in that meeting, you're armed with something on the recent developments of that company. Use Google Alerts to find as much, so you don't have to work for it, it comes into your inbox. You can find as much out about that company. The person, social media. You can almost find out anything about anyone on Facebook, LinkedIn, and Twitter. I'm constantly trying to watch what I put on there now because people start to search you and you think, oh, God. You know, you can find out anything about anybody. Let's research the person. What are they putting on LinkedIn? I had a guy who came for an interview with me 2 weeks ago, and he referred to something I'd put on LinkedIn 2 hours earlier, acknowledged it and said, and gave me an opinion on what I'd put. Guess what? He had me in a conversation for the first 10 minutes. Because he was talking about my IP that I'd put out there, my idea. Really, really great start to the interview because he'd taken the time to look at me as a person, what my interests are and what I'm focusing on. The meeting. What I want to... you've got to be free and flexible and have the clock speed to go anywhere in a meeting, right? That's what sales is. Two things I want you to think about preparing for the meeting. I want you to prepare for any questions. So I want you to prepare any questions that you need to ask in that meeting to uncover what you need to uncover. I'm going to come on to this in a second. Have you thought about what killer questions you need to ask to draw out the information you need? Or are you just going to see where the conversation goes? I always have two or three. There'll be some stuff that crops up in the moment. I always have two or three that I'm almost subtly in my book that I need to ask before I leave that meeting. Prepare your questions. Here's another one, objections. Prepare for the top three objections you're likely to get in that meeting about your product or service. You know what they are. You get them all the time. You can think of the number one objection you get on your product or service now instantly in your mind. Prepare for it. Get somebody in the scenario planet. We often do role plays in the office where, right, what if they say this? Lee and I, who's another consultant guy, what if they say this? How are you going to answer it? And he'll go, well, I'll answer it like this. That doesn't sound right to me. And we work on it. So in the meeting, it sounds entirely natural, but you are prepared to really answer that objection effectively and without emotion. Prepare the questions you're going to ask, open and probing, and prepare the objections you might face. And you will be so much more prepared in the meeting. The outcome, you want to prepare for the outcome. What do you want to leave that meeting with? I'm going to come on to a couple of techniques of how you can do this. But all I'm saying is take 10, 15 minutes. You've done all the hard work at this point. You can prepare for that meeting. If you become the octopus on roller skates in sales, where you're going in every direction but forwards, who feels like that at times, right? You become the octopus on roller skates. You tend to be, who's done that, where you're sat in the car park for a meeting and you're Googling the person and the company, and you're totally like lastminute.com trying to find anything else you can because you've just had a hectic week. Prepare for meetings and your pipeline velocity will increase. So steps 1 to 4, totally internal. It's hard graft, it's process, it's resilience. But at this point, all you've done is engineered an opportunity, right? 5, 6, and 7 on the sales work cycle separate the great salespeople from the average salespeople. It's just a fact. Step 5 is make a great first impression and uncover the most important needs. And we study neuroscience at Trans2, and we put a lot of neuroscience into our sales methodologies and around engaging with people and leading people. And Dale touched upon a few things which I'm going to build upon. But making a great first impression, I'm going to give you 5 tips on this before we look at going on the mission of discovering and uncovering needs. I'm going to give you 5 quick tips on making a great first impression. Has anybody read the book, The Chimp Paradox? Dale, anyone else? It changed my life. The book changed my life by Steve Peters. It's £7 off Amazon. It's the best-selling personal development book of the last 5 years, The Chimp Paradox. Steve Peters is a neuroscientist who worked with GB Cycling running up to the 2012 Olympics when we won everything. And he's taken a really complex part of the brain, and believe me, I've done so much research and studies on this. It is so common. I mean, we haven't found all the answers already, but we know quite a lot. But his version of it, for me, took a really complex topic in terms of the brain and made it so simple to understand. And I'm just going to share the principle of the 3 parts of the brain that interact when you meet people for the first time. Because when you go to a sales meeting, this happens in you and in them instantly. And this is why it's important to make a great first impression. This part of your brain here, the red bit, is the frontal lobe, the prefrontal cortex. It's what he calls it, the human, in the book. It's what makes sense of logic, fact, and rationale in our lives. It's your CEO. It's trying to guide you morally and with data and evidence to come to the right conclusions about people, decisions, and situations. Make sense? It's what makes us human. We have more neurons in that part of the brain than any other species on Earth, which is what makes us human. The second part he talks about is this rugby ball-shaped part in the middle here. And this is known as the limbic system. Dale alluded to it. It's the limbic system. It sits as the central nervous system right in the middle of your brain. And this controls your emotions and feelings, your gut instinct. And he calls that your chimp. So when you're chimping off or when you're flying off the handle or acting irrationally, it's your raw feelings and emotions. And the final part of the brain is this yellow part here, which is known as your computer. It's your parietal lobe. And it is simply your memory, if that makes sense. It stores your experiences and your memories to pull upon at a later stage. So the dynamic here, just move that microphone because it's the dynamic here is that your chimp and human are going through everyday life with you, assessing people, situations, and offering you insight based on feelings and emotions and logic. You then decide to act however you want to act, and you'll store it in your in your parietal lobe for a memory to come back on at a later stage. Let me give you an example. You all did this with me when I stood on the stage. Subconsciously, you did one or two things. You went, oh, this is going to be a long day. You looked at me and you literally went, oh, this is going to be another guy who's going to give it all this. Same content, different facilitator. What are you laughing at? or you went, he's all right, I'll give this a go. Your chimp made that by how I carried myself, how I talk, how I sound, how I come across. Friend or foe, Dale mentioned it. Friend or foe, that quick. Because your chimp, your limbic system, is 5 times quicker than the human. It's the first part of your brain to react and advise you in every situation because its primary role is survival. It's survival, it's protect you at all costs. So when you go into that sales meeting, to my point here, the first thing that triggers off in your client's or prospective client's mind is friend or foe. 10 seconds, that quick. I promise you, have you ever met somebody for the first time and you go, I just don't like them? There's just something about them, I just don't like them. Have you ever done that? And that is this, you don't know how they, you know, how they think, you don't know the content, you don't know if they're any value to you, but you've gone in or out. Yes or no, we do it all the time because this is what we're all different with our social styles and how we externalize ourselves, but this is the one thing that connects us all. Our limbic system is 5 times quicker than our human and it is acting irrationally on gut instinct. So you have to make a great first impression in your meetings. The first tip is you have to understand what's going on up here and why it's important to make the first impression. Their chimp is meeting you in the corridor going, hi, Steve, great to see you. And in 10 seconds, it's going like, don't like. And this is the great thing. What it then does for the rest of the hour is it will try to justify its initial assumption. If you've made a great first impression, if you've made a great one, the limbic system will try to find every reason why it will buy your products or service. If you've made an indifferent or a bad first impression, the chimp will try to find every reason why it shouldn't do business for you. And it's the same in interviews. You know whether you want to interview the person in the first minute. Don't lie and tell me different. You know instantly. You checked in or you checked out. This is neuroscience. This is what happens all the time. So the first tip is you need to understand. The second tip I'll give you is, therefore knowing that, great salespeople master the first 10 seconds, and I'm going to give you 3 tips on this. The number one is smile. Smile. There is a part of your brain, an almond-shaped part in that limbic system called the amygdala. And the amygdala is responsible for mimicking and mirroring when we have rapport with somebody else. So when you genuinely meet someone and you smile sincerely, they cannot help but smile back, and it builds rapport. If you're out the car and you're flustered, or you're having a bit of a bad morning, the temptation, we've all done it, is to go in and go, oh, sorry, Johnny, traffic's a nightmare, sorry. And you've lost the impetus. We've all done it. You don't even think about what you're doing with your face. Smile at people. The minute I got up on this stage, I tried to smile and engage you with an endearing facial expression. It builds instant rapport. The second tip I'll give you on this is make eye contact. Make eye contact. Introverts, are different to extroverts, and if anyone studied NLP, they'll say that kinesthetics don't like eye contact, etc. But the one thing that does build rapport and that is known to build rapport is when you are present and in the moment with people. It doesn't have to be piercing in too close and a bit freaky, but if you've smiled and you're making a great first impression, look them in the eyes. You are present, this hour is with you, and I'm in the moment. The third tip I'll give you on this is the greeting, the dreaded greeting. I've had some horrors with this. Usually in the UK, because it's different to different cultures, but in the UK, we shake hands, right? We shake hands. Anybody who's ever said a firm handshake with a squeeze is the right thing to do is rubbish. It's wrong. Have you ever enjoyed someone squeezing your hand? I had a client once who used to rock me to my boots. Give me a squeeze. I used to dread going in to see him. I dread it. I'd almost like shake his hand at a distance. It's wrong. Just a normal handshake is fine. On the contrary, you don't want the wet fish and a couple of fingers. excuse me. But you don't. You know what I mean by that is you don't want it where you grab. You know where you go for the handshake and you end up with this and it's all a bit awkward and you think, oh Jesus. You want a normal handshake. Now, man to man, it's given that it's a handshake. Man to woman, I've had it before where I've gone there, she's come in for a kiss. I've then gone backwards and then it's like, oh God. Yeah, sometimes a double kiss, is it one, is it two? I mean, in this country, we're lucky, it's generally a handshake. But a normal handshake is fine. There's no need to rock somebody to the boots, all right? And they're just three tips I'll give you on the first 10 seconds, but the first 10 seconds are really important. Just think about this. You don't think about this. Smile, eye contact, endearing, with a really warm and genuine greeting, you're off to a great start. The next tip I'll give you on this, and this is a big mistake I see in the field with salespeople, make your early exchanges entirely about the client, about the other person. And this is even in social excellence, in meeting people in the pub or whatever it might be. Make your early exchanges entirely about the other person. If you think about it, what we tend to do is go, hi, my name is, or hi, let me introduce myself, or hi, I've had a bad morning in traffic, and you talk instantly about yourself. Just flip that on its head. Hi, how are you? This is a great one. Hi, it's great to meet you. It's great to meet you. When, a bit of neuroscience for you, we release four main chemicals in our brain, but we release serotonin when we feel powerful and influential. And when you say to somebody, hi, it's great to meet you, sincerely, you will release serotonin in their mind, which elevates them to you, and it's, yeah, thank you, I appreciate that. Releases serotonin, it builds rapport straight away. Make your early exchanges entirely about the other person. Second tip on this, resist, who was I talking to at lunch? I can't remember who it was. Resist the temptation to turn, it might have been Alan, to turn the conversation immediately back on yourself. Are you genuinely actively listening, or are you waiting for your turn to talk? Was it you, Alan, me and you was talking about this? Or are you waiting for your turn to talk? I've done it. Sales meeting, I'm prepped, I'm pumped. It's going to be a biggie, and I just want to get on with my pitch, right? So I have the niceties, and then bang, I'm in. You know, first bit thing to say, I'm in. Right, never mind about you, what about me? Right, I've been there before. The temptation is so much. Resist the temptation to turn the conversation immediately back on yourself. Actively listen, ask second-level questions. Keep the conversation with the other person. So that's just a couple of tips for... you know, how do you find common ground quickly? We ask questions. Ask questions, your pre-prepared questions that you want to get off to a great start. Ask lots of questions and let them talk. Somebody mentioned it. What I find, and again, it's a little bit of psychology, great salespeople in their early exchanges capture people's names and use them in meetings at every opportunity. Again, it releases serotonin. Great facilitators and presenters do this a lot. They engage people by name, i.e. Alan. As soon as I said Alan, he went like that. Look, he brought him instantly to the present. He was writing some notes. I said, I was speaking to Alan, and he looks up, he's engaged, that's me. What you need to do is capture the person's name. Of course, you'll know the person's mate you're gonna meet. Not overdo it and be overzealous with it, but at certain points when the client says something that we're going to come on to, which is really, really compelling to the situation, do you know what, John, that's a great thought process. Do you know what? It's great. It's really interesting that you say that, John. When you use people's names in meetings and replay it back to them, it brings them immediately back to the present and it builds rapport. So when and where possible, has anybody ever been in a meeting where you got the name on the introduction and you forgot it? And all meeting, they're going, so Martin, what's your thoughts? And you're going, oh, mate, oh. Because you've been in the moment and you forgot to even recognise the person's name, and it is so awkward to the point where then you're trying to engineer it out on the subtle, on the sly, all meeting, and you're not focusing on what you should be focusing on. Great salespeople capture people's names, they remember them, and they use them at every opportunity to keep people in the meeting, in the present. Does that make sense? And the final tip on this is great salespeople build rapport by subtly mirroring other people's verbal and nonverbal communication. If in doubt, mirror. Right? I'm going to give a couple of tips on nonverbal communication. I've been in with salespeople before who, yes, some people are nervous in sales meetings. Now, usually, there'll only be two positions you're going to be in, stood if you're presenting, or sat usually in a meeting room, right? You're going to be sat with the person having a conversation. If you're sat, I've seen it before where a salesperson has come in. Is that all right? I'm not blocking anything. So where a salesperson comes in and they're a bit jittery and they've got the laptop bag and they're a bit like, right, and they're pulling chairs out and they sit down and then they're fluffing around inside the bag here and they're, right, so, and it's all a little bit awkward. Does that make sense? We have low and high power body language when we meet people. High power, remember this, if your client displays high power body language, it's anything that's open. I display a lot of high power when I'm presenting just because I'm a raving extrovert who can't keep still. But a lot of people will present high power. Some people will present low power, which is closed. Sometimes a hand on a chin, sometimes in the pockets. I'm reserved, I'm low power, we are equals. it's a nice placid conversation. So if you think about that from a seating perspective, you know, usually they'll either be sat up at the desk, arms on the table, ready for the meeting, it's going to be strictly professional. All I would simply say is, if that's the case, really subtly move your chair forward, book on the desk, peer to peer, and you mirror. People like people, whom are like who? Like themselves. Sorry, can you not see me at the back? I'm seeing you going. People like people, whom are like who? Like themselves. Subtly mirror, push your chair up, arm on the table, and let's mirror. If they kick back in their chair, because this is what I often do to make people comfortable, and they cross their legs, low power, and they lean back, just simply kick back, cross your legs, and mirror. If you can mirror body language really subtly in sales meetings, you will start making a great first impression and building that rapport even greater. Does that make sense? Because sometimes we don't know where to sit, how to sit, what looks professional, what doesn't, what should I do? Just mirror. You take, let them take the lead. Now, if they kick back and give it the old, right, you've got 10 seconds, go, I wouldn't recommend that you kick back and go, all right, let's go, you know. I wouldn't recommend that. But if it's extreme, try not to. But when and where you can, subtly mirror the seating position of the person in the sales meeting. If you're stood giving a presentation, a couple of tips for you. If you have to stand up in a boardroom or whatever it might be, slow your movements down. I'm quite fast in terms of the way I move. And one of the things I try to do is really slow down if I am going to move or move my arms or the way I walk. Now, when I first started presenting, I watched myself back on video and I was a classic hand in pocket. It was like my safety zone. If I've got my hand in my pocket, I'm okay. And every now and then, just to change it up, I'd go like that and deliver. And sometimes, if I was feeling really good, I'd give it a double. And I thought, take your hands out your pockets. For God's sake, take your hands out your pockets. So I bought one of these. And since I've bought one of these, it allows me just sometimes, if I am feeling or struggling with what to do with my body language, I can subtly pass it from hand to hand, point at things with it, and just seem more natural. If you're using flip chart, hold a pen. Even if you're not going to use it, hold a pen. Because we portray confidence and what we call executive presence, which is a really good trait in salespeople, when we are natural, fluid, and confident when we sit or stand in sales meetings. Subtly mirror the other person as a rule of thumb when you're seated. Any questions, or does that make sense? Yeah? So the last part of step five, make a great first impression. Now you've got to uncover the most important needs, right? I'm going to really simplify this for you. I'm going to give you four nuggets that I promise you can take away from today. And in every sales meeting, my challenge to you is link your product or service to one of the big four I'm about to share with you. On the mission of discovery, right, your job is to simply, I think Dale slightly mentioned this as well, you either are going to help a client exploit an opportunity in their business, or you're going to help a customer solve a problem. You can simplify to those two categories. You're going to either help a customer exploit an opportunity or solve a problem. That's the first level of it. And we put this to the test and we surveyed it. And I wanted to get to the bottom with what type of things, what was the most common reason that buyers buy from us, no matter what the product or service, but in business, what's the most common reason that investments get signed off? And I found that there's a big four. There's four reasons. And I want you to write these down. And I want you to think about, does your product or service contribute to these big four reasons in your customers? The first one was increased sales. Believe me, as a business owner, the number one priority, and for any of you who are business owners, we want more sales. If your product or service or what you provide can help a customer increase their sales or their sales productivity, they're in. You've got an audience. You've got a compelling reason to buy, which we're going to come on to. The first big reason buyers buy is if you can help, if your product or service or your company can help them increase sales. The second one, of course, is reduce costs. If your product or service or what you provide can help a customer reduce the costs in their business, and believe me, I'm in this boat right now with my company, my transport company, cost me an arm and a leg, Sam, it's your fault. But the running costs of that business, it's like, oh, it's scary. You start to look at how much it costs. So what I'm interested in now is, yes, I want you to help me increase my sales, but can you help me reduce my costs and be more, and the corporate term is increase operational efficiency. If you can help you, your primary two of the big four, and this is it, your product or service, everybody in the room, it doesn't matter whether you're a law firm, recruitment consultant, you offer a tech product, it doesn't matter what it is, you can either directly or indirectly link that product or service to one of those two things potentially. It might be so blatantly obvious that you talk track strong, it might be that you have to go on a story and articulate why you can do that. The third reason of the big four, why buyers buy, enhance customer experience. So this is saying if your product or service can help me deliver better products or services to my customers, which keeps them coming back, if I can increase the experience to my customer through your product or service, I'll buy, I'm in. And the fourth and final reason of the big four is, does it drive employee engagement or productivity? Engagement or productivity. Does your product or service, does it help me in my business engage my employees more and make them more productive? Which will in turn inadvertently drive the top two. Four big reasons companies buy. Increase sales, reduce costs, enhance customer experience, or drive employee engagement or productivity. Now, here's the thing. These are what we call business outcomes. 90% of sales activity I observe and I dissect in mature businesses, small, medium, and large, they focus on features, functionality, and benefits of what you do. You focus on your product, how great it is, how you've made it, how you deliver it. You focus on all the additions they'll get, whether there's rebate charges and all the rest of it, how competitive you are. You focus on the features and functionality and benefits of your products and service. And even we do sometimes, I don't care who you are, it's natural, because it's this adage of selling. These are business outcomes for your customer. The day you start focusing on business outcomes in your articulation in sales meetings and not features, functionality, and benefits, that will come when the decision's made. Or that will come to reinforce a decision. When you start talking about what you do for others and the true business outcomes you can drive, you watch your sales go through the roof. The big four. And you, what I would do in the break or at lunch, I would think about which of those big four is your product or service related to. It might be a couple of them, it might be one big one. But the minute you start talking that language to customers, you're seriously in the game.